Have any of you ever attended a healing service?
It's a real blessing.
Has anyone ever prayed for healing for yourself or for someone else?
Yes, yes.
Since the very beginning of time, the ministry of healing has played a vital and central part in human history. The Bible shows us the significance of that ministry of healing in the Judeo-Christian story. There are biblical stories of healing, healing of body, healing of mind, healing of spirit, healing of relationships and of communities and of nations. The very first chapter of the very first book of the Bible says that the world was made good, very, very good. And then the story goes on throughout the generations and generations to show us how, in so many ways, the wholeness and basic integrity of this world is broken because of human sin. And the result of that brokenness is not only death, but even the challenges that prevent us from fully enjoying the riches of this amazing, very, very good world that we have been given, that God has made. But we also learn from the very beginning of the book that it is God's plan to restore the wholeness of the earth and of all who dwell therein, to bring people to the fullness of joy that is possible in this world. That fullness, that wholeness, that completeness is what is known as abundant life. That is God's plan for humankind, abundant life, God's greatest desire for all persons. So, if abundant life is God's greatest desire, then sometimes we have to ask, why aren't things better? Why haven't we been made whole yet? The prophet Jeremiah says, is there no balm in Gilead? I read about a book called A Broken Heart Still Beats After Your Child Dies. According to Amazon, this book is a remarkable collection of poetry, fiction, and essays about the pain, the stages of grief, and the coping and healing process that follow the death of one's child. It's offered to help parents to deal with that loss. The editors have each tragically lost a child of their own, and they contend that the death of a child is not something that one gets over. Would you agree? Not something that you work through eventually. At best, you learn to live with the sorrow and the pain, but the sorrow never goes fully away. One section of the book begins with these words: time heals nothing. In many ways, that's true. Time alone heals nothing. So then what? Is there no balm in Gilead? You know, I've invested a lot of my life in learning words, all kinds of words, for all kinds of purposes and careers and functions. But in spite of all those words, some of the most important words that I know are very simple ones that I knew way before I started college, way before I started high school, before I started school at all. Three little words. I don't know. I don't know. I don't know why children die. I don't know why hurricanes make last-minute turns, sparing some and bringing devastation to others. I don't know why troubles seem to multiply for some folks. I don't know why marriages fall apart. I don't know why diseases like AIDS develop. I don't know why seemingly healthy folks get cancer. I don't know why sometimes, maybe even most times, God seems absent. There are so many things that I just don't know. I am aware that there are people who do claim to know why these things happen. People who are convinced that God is behind it all, teaching us lessons, granting us rewards, exacting retribution, meting out punishment according to some inscrutable plan. I don't know about all that. I think, that presuming to know why God does what God does and what it is that God is up to is risky business. I don't know how hurricanes and diseases and children's deaths and broken relationships fit within the providence of God, the good God. I don't know how a God who wills bad things can in any way resemble the God who has come among us in Jesus Christ. I believe that God acts on our behalf in the midst of that pain, but not causing it. Now, as important as it is about to admit what I don't know, it's equally important, and maybe even more important, to cling to what I do know. I'm reminded of that by the story of a woman named Angelina Giulio. Got that? Angelina Giulio. She is from the Sudan. We know that the Sudan is a country in Africa that's been beset by war and famine for many years. Thousands have died in the Sudan, particularly in Darfur. Thousands are still at risk. It is a grave situation. Here's what Angelina Giulio, who was a seminary student at the time, wrote about what's going on in her country. In Sudan, we have never had or experienced full peace. We were born in war and have borne our children also in war. Our lives are ever unstable. We do not know what it means to have a leftover or an excess of anything. We live in want of security, stability, wealth, love, health, home, etc. We are deprived of all our rights, the right of defense, the right of ownership of our land, the right to enjoy life as it was given to us by God. We have no freedoms of any kind anywhere. The world seems to weigh very heavy on our shoulders with no one to help but Christ. That is what I know, that in the midst of all the challenges to life, Christ is there to help. I don't know why the suffering is so wide or so intense, whether it's in the Sudan or in Afghanistan or Iraq or Syria or so many other places around the world, even in our own communities. I don't know. But I do know that Angelina is right. I do know that Christ is present in each of those places. And I do know that Christ will help, even when no one else will or even when no one else can. In spite of all that I do not know, I do know that our lives are in Christ's hands. I do know that God's love for us has no boundaries. I do know that there is someone to heal us. There is someone to make us well. In terms of our theme of discipleship by the sea, this week someone sent me these words which really fit who we are. He wrote, "The church on the Cape is by the sea. It is a lighthouse for all wandering and wondering and or lost souls. We feed them, clothe them, nurture them to good mental, physical, and spiritual health as we are guided by the Holy Spirit." Pretty good description of our call as a community of believers, right? These things God calls us to as a community of faith are not just the physical things that we do, but the spiritual as well. There are many people whom we know, people whose bodies are completely free, free in the physical sense. They come and go where they want, and yet they are imprisoned. They're imprisoned in their hearts or minds or souls, captive to anxiety or fear, bound by a sense of despair. They may mourn the loss of a person dear to them, but the loss of the sense of God's care and God's goodness toward them or towards those whom they love leads to even more mourning. There are also many people who are bound up by sin, whether it's their own sin or the sins that others have committed against them, sins that they have not yet been able to forgive, even though they want to. People who need to be set free, who need what we call inner healing, inner peace, inner wholeness. And there are those who are in need of physical restoration, whose bodies are in rebellion, in pain, in disease. We are called to minister to all these and to proclaim the good news of God's love in the midst of that. And one of the wonderful blessings of this church is how well you do that in caring for one another and in caring for those who call for our help and our need and our prayers. The confidential prayer group is amazing to me, that prayers going out from this place from prayer warriors in this church all the time. We know that we do not make that difference all by ourselves. We know that God does it on account of us and on account of God's own name, God's glory. God does it for God's own splendor and is a testament to God's word and a fulfillment of God's promises. And our part is to trust in God, to believe in God, for ourselves and for others who can't yet trust in God, to believe in God for ourselves and for those who can't yet believe in God. And our part is to do the simple things, the necessary things that help us to answer the prayers that we make. So if we pray for bread for the poor, it is for us to share bread with the poor and to continue to do that. If we pray for healing for cancer, it's our job to take good care of our way of living and to support those who are the healers out there caring for others. Our part is to do what we can do and to come in trust and faith to God, asking for healing and wholeness in God's way. God, this is our concern. Thy will be done. We do that so beautifully. We need to keep on doing that. Do it with me. God, here's our concern. Thy will be done. Thank you. I would tell you today that I have seen a lot of sorrow in my life, but I've also seen some amazing healings. I've seen cancers arrested. I've witnessed someone who was not supposed to live walk through the doors of the church on Christmas Eve to be with their family. I've seen God provide for the poor, partly through God's people bringing groceries at just the right time, or leaving money at just the right time anonymously, when the only hope that that person had was the hope that they expressed through prayer. I've seen those who had only weeks to live, who were frightened and afraid, come to a place of peace, knowing that God had something wonderful in store for them. I've seen many prayers answered and wonderful things happen, and I suspect if we took a few moments around this congregation, you'd have some wonderful stories to tell of healings that you have seen as well. The most wonderful thing that I have ever seen is the journey to wholeness that has happened as men and women and young people who have been touched by God have sought the Lord or had others seek the Lord on their behalf when they did not know it. And they have found him. They have found God and changed their lives because of it. Is there no balm in Gilead? Is there no one to save us? Oh, I know the answer. The answer is yes. That one I do know. There is a balm to make the wounded whole. There is someone to save us. There is a balm to heal the sin-sick soul. It is so, and that's why I'm here. And I have a suspicion that's why you're here as well. Because you know it is so. Or maybe you suspect it is so. Or maybe you hope it is so. God has a plan for abundant life for each of us and for all of us. And God calls us to pray and claim that plan. So I want to finish this prayer with this sermon with a moment of prayer together. And I want to invite you to think just for a moment. We'll take a moment of silence as you think through your personal prayer list of someone who's not present here today, who needs prayer. One person whom you bring to your heart to be helped by God. Just take a moment in silence to think about that. And now I'm going to ask you to turn to someone right next to you and tell them that person's name and maybe just briefly what the concern is, very briefly. Take a moment. Thank you. And now let's take a moment together in silence to pray for the person whose name you were just given. Lord. Lord, hear our prayers. Gracious and loving God, what a special privilege it is to name in prayer those precious persons that you have created and placed on our hearts and minds today. We bring each one to you in the light and love of Jesus Christ. Thank you for helping and healing as you did on that shoreline so long ago. Amen.